The unopinionated nature of React is a two-edged sword. On the one hand, you get freedom of choice. On the other hand, many projects end up with a custom and often messy architecture. This article is the seventh part of a series about software architecture and React apps, where we take a codebase with lots of bad practices and refactor it step by step. See my playlist named React Architecture for more videos and check the article linked in the description where you can find a waitlist for the course. Previously, we separated business logic from the components. In this video, we'll focus on the core of our application, the domain. Domain logic is code that operates on the domain models like a user object. That may sound abstract, but we'll see what it means in some hands-on examples. The goal is to isolate this logic from our components, move it to a specific place in the repository and unit test it. If you've ever wondered where you can place certain parts of logic, if not a utility file or a custom hook, this might be an interesting watch. Let's have a look at a problematic code example. Here's a component that renders a list of shouts, which you can think of as tweets or posts. Let's go through it quickly. The component receives a list of shouts together with a list of users and images that belong to these shouts. It iterates over these shouts. For each of the shouts, it gets the corresponding author and the image. Finally, it returns a list item element for each shout. So what's the problem? The culprit are these two lines that find the author and image of a shout. These are operations on the user and image entities. Namely, this code defines how the user and image lookup work in our application. Additionally, there's a possibility that a shout doesn't have an image. Because of that, we need a ternary expression. From my perspective, that's not the most beautiful or readable code. Alright, but what's the solution? In an earlier video, we created a domain layer holding the core models of our application, like user or image, as TypeScript interfaces. This turns out to be a great place to put logic that operates on domain entities as well. Let me show you in three simple steps where we create functions in the domain layer, update the component, and write a unit test for the new functions. Let's create a new function. Now, this would be enough to be used in the component, but what I like to do with these domain functions is make the parameters optional. From my experience, this makes applying the functions to asynchronous data from the server much easier, especially if we're working with, for example, React Query. Let's do the same thing for the image. Next, let's update the component. We can replace the two lines here with our new functions. The annoying ternary is gone, but we can take it one step further and remove the curly brackets, which makes the code even more concise. From my perspective, this code has a couple of advantages. First, the code is more readable because the reader's brain doesn't have to translate the users.find functions into ID lookups. Instead, you can read what's happening in plain English, like get user by ID. Second, we got rid of the ternary expression, further improving readability. Third, the logic is now much simpler to test. Wait, what do I mean by simpler to test? In the original code, we'd have to test the logic by rendering the component and accessing it with, for example, React testing library. Plus, for each path, we'd have to provide different versions of the shouts, users, and images props. Let's take the image ID as an example. We'd have to provide shouts with and without image ID, render the component accordingly, and check that the list item is rendered with or without image. All of this just to test that getting the shout image by ID works correctly. Compared to that, writing unit tests for our new domain function is very straightforward. We can test all the possible branches without any setup code as often required by React testing library. Plus, these tests are blazing fast. With these unit tests in place, we might have the opportunity to remove some of the more expensive integration tests that would otherwise be required. Okay, before we wrap up the video, let me show you another example. In the previous video, we created a hook that exposes a use case function as a way to remove business logic from a component. This function first runs a few lines of validation logic, followed by a series of service calls. So what's the problem here? The problematic lines of code are in the data validation, namely the check if the user exceeded the daily shout limit and the check if the recipient blocked the current user. These are again operations on domain entities, user and me, which is the current user. You probably know the proposed solution, right? We again move this logic to the domain layer. We can also introduce a local constant to get rid of the magic number. Now the domain is responsible for deciding whether or not a user has exceeded the shout limit. This allows us to remove implementation details from the code that's closer to the UI, such as the number of shouts allowed and the interval for this threshold, in this case 1 day. Now let's do the same with a check of the blocked user IDs. And again, we can use these new functions to simplify the original code. From my perspective, this reads simpler and, as mentioned, contains less implementation detail related to the domain, for example, how many times a user can shout in a given interval. As before, we can now write simple unit tests for this domain logic. I won't bother you with that though. Instead, let's quickly discuss the pros and cons of extracting domain logic. First, the advantages. 1. Less utility functions. Without the domain layer, it's often unclear where you put logic like the above. From my experience, it's typically scattered around the components, or you can find it in utility files. Utility files can become problematic though, as they easily turn into a dumping ground for all kinds of shared code. 2. Readability. Translating users.find and so on into ID lookup requires a bit of cognitive overload. Reading get users by ID instead is much more descriptive. That's especially effective if you have many of these lines grouped together, for example, at the top of a component. 3. Testability. You can often find code that uses if or switch statements or ternaries. Each of these mean that there are multiple test branches to be covered. It can be much easier to write unit tests for all the edge cases and reduce the number of integration tests to the ones being strictly necessary. 4. Reusability. Often these small pieces of logic might not seem worthy of being extracted into separate functions. Then they are repeated in the code indefinitely. But a small change of requirements can easily lead to a bigger refactoring. 5. Searchability. It's not that simple to run a global search on, for example, users.find. The code might be written in different ways, with different variable names. A global search for get user by ID is straightforward though. Now the disadvantages. 1. Overhead. With extracting all these small pieces of logic into separate functions, we have to write more code. Also, as you've seen in one of the examples above, we made some of the domain functions more flexible than required by this specific component. Here, we made the user and user ID parameters optional. Since we also covered these cases with unit tests, we introduced more code than required, leading to more maintenance effort. At the same time, this can save our butt if we, for example, suddenly encounter unexpected response data from the server. 2. Training. Not every developer is used to thinking in different kinds of logic, so documentation and training might be required if you want to keep your codebase consistent. Maybe I'm biased, but I couldn't come up with more disadvantages. Anyway, let me wrap up this video. Until now, we didn't introduce any other tool than React itself. From my perspective, this was important, as it can be difficult to transfer knowledge from one tech stack to another if things are mingled together. In the next video, we'll introduce one of the most popular tools in the React ecosystem, React Query. Until then, check out the video in the React Architecture playlist and the blog post mentioned in the video description with the waitlist for a course focused on software architecture and React apps. And of course, don't forget to subscribe.